Okay, well, welcome to the 2012 Detroit Auto Show. I'm joined by Ben Oliver, contributing editor to Car Magazine, and a very familiar face to lots of you, George Kacker, Car Magazine's long-standing European editor. So, very quickly, George, what do you make of the show at the NAIAS 2012 so far?
It's a good show. It's it shows that America is alive and kicking. It shows the presence of the American car makers with a complete Ford model range, most of which looks very familiar to us Europeans because they go global product-wise, and with the Fusion we're getting the first American Ford that becomes the next Mondeo, with Fiat Chrysler looking relatively good on the product, on the production car front, less so on some of the concepts. When you look at the Voyager replacement, for instance, which is an acquired taste, and then last but not least, General Motors also with an ATS Cadillac that rivals the 3 Series, and with a strong range of trucks. So I think, yeah, Detroit is not dead.
It's interesting, isn't it? We're sitting here in a Ford F-150. We've got 3 of the larger members of the car team here, so we decided to go for a big car this time. But they sold, I believe, 585,000 of these last year. So the American market is still about trucks, but it is changing, Ben, isn't it?
Well, it's very interesting that it's such a big-selling vehicle from the F-150, yet it's buried here right at the back of the Ford stand, almost out of sight, almost like they're ashamed of it. But as you say, it is comfortably the best-selling vehicle in the American market. I mean, it's trucks like this that the American market is really all about. But, I mean, the theme for the show, we often talk about in these chats what the show theme is. For me, it's kind of small cars, to be honest. We've seen, you know, as George says, the Cadillac ATS, which is their first very small car since the terrible Cadillac Chimaran back in the 1980s. It was based on a Vauxhall Cavalier. We've seen the new Dodge Dart as well, another small car. A lot of small concepts as well. Size really matters, I think, in Detroit, as the car manufacturers try and reduce the corporate average fuel economy. Actually, to be honest, it's vehicles like this that Americans really still want to buy, but they're having these smaller cars pushed at them. It's interesting the way this thing, which is, you know, a real American icon, is kind of almost, you know, sort of ashamedly tucked away at the back of the stand. So, but, you know, there are still big, powerful, exciting cars. If you go and look for them, we've got the 650 horsepower cabriolet version of the Ford GT 500 next to us. But yeah, size is really the issue.
I mean, you mentioned the Dodge Dart. I think it's interesting, George, isn't it, to see how quickly that's come about. It's only, you know, a couple of years ago that Fiat came in and saved Chrysler, props it up, and here we are, the new product based on an Alfa Romeo already. I mean, Chrysler's growth last year was ahead of the other big two in America, wasn't it? Do you think they're back on course?
Well, they came from a very low. They're climbing fast. It's above all the Jeep division that does it for them at the moment. Passenger cars are still wanting the 300. You know, it's an old car based on an old Mercedes E-Class. It's still a very imposing looking car here at the show. I think they're struggling with future products on the passenger car side, still just as Fiat is with passenger cars. Fiat has the Cinquecento and the Panda, but above that, like Chrysler, they're still searching for a new identity, also a new engineering identity, and the assumption that we'll, in Europe, buy all those surplus Chryslers rebadged as Lancias, I think, won't fly.
No, I mean, that's a classic sort of shortcut strategy they've pulled off, isn't it? I think in the next few years we're going to start seeing the companies who've carried on investing in R&D during the difficult times. And I'm sort of, I suppose, thinking of the Volkswagen Group, who spent, they told me yesterday, I think it's $6 billion in R&D annually as a group. Those are companies who are going to reap the benefits now, aren't they, when the good times return, if they do.
Absolutely, but Germany used to dominate Detroit in the past with new concepts and with fresh production cars. Well, this is not the case this year. Look, an Audi Q3 with a roof rack and skis on it, badged veil. That is their star of the show. I mean, for Christ's sake. You know, it's interesting that they have the intention to sell the Q3 in America, but as a concept, they could have done better. Volkswagen was the e-Bugster, a Beetle, chopped roof Beetle convertible with the drivetrain of the e-Golf. That's not not really a lot. BMW has nothing new yet at all. New 3 Series, yes. Project I we've seen before, so they don't even bother. Mercedes, nothing truly important. Yes, for Europe, perhaps the E300 hybrid, which is the first European-focused attempt to sell a hybrid engine passenger car in more volume than a 12-cylinder sports car. But apart from that, Germany is low-key.
I mean, talking of tech, Ben, has any tech advances caught your eye here? It was interesting, after being at the Toyota press conference, and they said that 10 years ago there were two hybrids here. You will struggle to walk around a Detroit show in 2012 and not see one on every single stand, won't you? But that's almost a minimum barrier to entry now, rather than a sort of, you know, look at us, we've got a hybrid, isn't it?
I mean, again, talking about sort of show themes, we've discussed the fact that there have been green themes in the past and EV themes and everything else, but now we just absolutely expect the car manufacturers to have a full, you know, sort of lineup of hybrids and electric vehicles, and also for the concepts that they show to have, you know, even if it is just, you know, sort of high in the sky, some sort of hybrid powertrain powering them. The most significant, or the most interesting, I think, trial of the show for me is a Honda NSX, which is, of course, a hybrid. You know, it'll have a mid-engine V6 and then two electric motors in the front wheels. That was interesting. We were at the unveil together, and you get a very sort of cynical, seen it all before kind of crowd at motor shows. When the covers were whipped off that car, it got a genuine spontaneous round of applause and a whole load of whoops as well. People were genuinely excited about it. They love to see Honda innovating again. They love to see Honda producing a genuinely exciting car to drive. It was interesting as well, they managed to keep the car secret up until that point. It hadn't sort of leaked out onto the internet and been scooped as so many of these concepts are. Also, crucially, it'll be designed and engineered and built in the United States, and that again got a big sort of spontaneous cheer. So, but again, of course, there's a lot of tech content in that car. Nothing particularly radically new. I mean, we expect the car makers to do it now. So in terms of platforms and underpinnings, I mean, again, one of the most significant cars of the show for me is that new Dodge Dart, because it comes from the alliance between Chrysler and Fiat. It's one of the first examples we've seen of them putting into practice what they were talking about, taking Fiat and Alfa technology, small car technology, and offering it in the US to buyers who are more interested in small cars. How well it drives is a different matter. The new Ford Fusion, which of course will become the Ford Mondeo, coming back in the opposite direction, is a car that's been engineered in the US. Now, I think we like the idea of this sort of one Ford policy of, you know, all their products being engineered for global markets when that engineering is done in Europe, and we've sent them the Fiesta and we've sent them the Focus, and those cars drive one. How well a car engineered in the US will drive when you get it across to Europe, I think, remains to be seen. I think there's probably a degree of cynicism there about from people about how well that car will do. Yeah. But very significant for the US market. That's a car that sells 250,000 units a year in the US.
They're calling it a new platform, but I know George and I have spent a bit of time with the Ford people, haven't we? And they are talking about it being, there's a lot of familiar bits from the old Mondeo, but the suspension is all new, the power steering is new, they're talking new. I think the Europeans have had quite a handle on it. Yeah. So.
And not a fabulously exciting car to look at, I'm afraid. It's a little bit like a sucked sweet.
And I can hear the Metro going overhead. Now, it's got a sort of last sort of minutes, a couple of minutes before George has to dive off for another top-level interview. It's been a show more about production cars, maybe even sort of wacky or out-there concept cars. Do you think that's fair to say, George?
It's fair to say. I think it's also a show about hybrids and electric vehicles, and it's a show that is dominated, although not visible, by the imponderables related to these vehicles. There is a whole catalogue of unknowns, both for the consumer and the manufacturer, as far as the future of hybrids and electric vehicles goes. You know, everybody is backing them, everybody thinks they need to have them, but to what extent and at what time and most importantly at what cost we'll see them come to market, I think that remains the biggest question mark that is looming not only above the Detroit show but also above 2012 in general and probably above the next 1 or 2 years. Just think, for instance, Iran closing the Strait of Hormuz and crude doubling in price to $200. That would change the scenario overnight, and I can think of maybe 25 influences like that. So, you know, we're looking at individual vehicles, but the bigger picture may change those individual vehicles very, very quickly.
Indeed. Well, on that bombshell, we've got busy schedules here. We've got some interviews to go off and do, but that's a sort of quite a nice, interesting sum up of the 2012 Detroit Auto Show. We'll have more in the magazine, which is out in mid-January, and then again in mid-February, where we'll be analysing the show further. So thank you very much, Ben Oliver, George Kaka, I'm Tim Pollard, and you can get more on www.carmagazine.co.uk.